Let's now talk to Terry Ridon, convener of policy think tank InfraWatch PH. Hi, Terry. Good morning.
Good morning, Michelle. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for joining us. So the MIAA letter to Megawide did not specify any reason as to why the first proponent status was revoked. Could you give us a read on why you think government pulled the rug off on this one?
Well, I think what needs to be stated once again is that the Department of Transportation to the MIAA has once again thrown the public sector and the private sector and the public under the bus. They had done so last week without taking accountability on the problems in the tollways. They're doing it this week once again on the airport sector by canceling the original proponent status. And the absence of a reason as to why they had canceled the OPS for the second private proponent gives us pause as to the exact reasons as to why they actually did it. Because absent of fraud, we don't think there's any valid justification for the MIAA and for the DOTR to basically just cancel it without further justification.
Mm-hmm. Between this cancellation and, of course, the anti-dummy violation allegations against Megawide, one can't help but think, napopolitika ba ang Megawide?
Well, I think that is something that can basically be said about this entire situation. Because we have to go back to the letter of the NEDA-ICC signed by the DOF Secretary Dominguez and NEDA Secretary Carl Chua. They never really stated the reason why they sent it back, except that they wanted the DOTR and the private proponent to basically complete all the documentation because they had some reservations on the debt-equity ratio of the private proponents. No? And what we would have wanted to see was for DOTR, MIAA, and the private proponent to negotiate hard, to negotiate further, and to conduct another submission to the NEDA-ICC. We never expected that DOTR and MIAA would unilaterally cancel the original proponent status of the second proponent. And this is a problem, particularly because it sets back the NAIA rehabilitation to another what? Another 1 year, another 2 years, and probably beyond already the term of President Duterte.
Mm-hmm. We're going to get to President Duterte's term there. I wanted to go back to the storyline there because Megawide did resubmit, did complete the submission of the documents being demanded by the NEDA and the ICC. And they did say, you know, on many occasions that they have the financial muscle to fund this. They can't come up with the money. So why do you think this happened? I mean, this was a joint filing by DOTR and Megawide, right?
That's correct. And that is what is making us very surprised. And it makes us frustrated because this is supposed to be a joint undertaking by government and the private sector to submit to the NEDA-ICC. And this is what you can actually say that linagled na naman po ng DOTR ang publiko at ng second private proponent. They had done so already in the first proponent, no? With the NAIA Super Consortium. And they've done it again yesterday by canceling the OPS. So, hindi mo natin malaman, what do they actually want with the NAIA rehabilitation? It needs to be stated as well that the rehabilitation of NAIA is among the priority projects of the President. And with this delay, talagang ang nakikita po ng publiko dito, eh parang hindi ho alam ng DOTR ang gusto ho niyang mangyari sa pagpapaganda po ng premier airport ng atin pong bansa.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, Terry, because I'm going to think that since this is the President's legacy project, one could be a legacy project, that DOTR should want this the most, should want to deliver this project the most.
That's correct. And I would say that like what we had previously stated, absent of fraud. We don't exactly know what other reasons mm-hmm. that the DOTR and the MIAA have for canceling this project. Mm-hmm. And I think the second private proponent had stated it clearly. If debt equity ratios are very important to NEDA-ICC and to the DOTR, this is something that they are willing to jointly resolve with the DOTR and MIAA. And in fact, that actually taken in JMR once again, not just as a technical partner, but also as an equity partner. So I think that commitment, and also mm-hmm. the credit commitment by one of the country's leading banks, I think that should already be sufficient to show the NED-ICC and mm-hmm. to show the DOTR and the MIAA that the second private proponent is basically ready to proceed towards the next phase. Mm-hmm. Of the original proponent status.
Of course, we have been trying to reach MIAA for their side. So far, no feedback yet. But you know, Terry, amid challenges to Megawide, another airport seems to be moving along quite smoothly. Ramon Ang San Miguel Corporation, in fact, just tapped Dutch firm Boskalis for preparation works on the Bulacan Airport project. It seems to be a tale of two airports. What do you make of this?
Well, I think the government is interested in implementing a multi-airport strategy for the capital region. And what is most important is that both these things need to proceed as it should. Firstly, the Bulacan Airport will not be there in the next 5 to 10 years. So a real airport that is able to take in all of the volume, that is able to reduce the congestion that we're currently facing today, needs to be there. And it ought to be the NAIA and not Bulacan. And I think more importantly, there are still ongoing social and environmental issues that are being lodged into the Bulacan Airport as well, notwithstanding our own reservations on the tax perks that had been granted by the Congress and the Senate to the Bulacan Airport as a new franchise. So all of these things, the Bulacan Airport will still have to confront in the next coming months, mm-hmm. in the next coming year. So, which is why then the ER rehabilitation cannot wait any longer. What is important is for the DOTR to fast-track this matter and at the very best reconsider the proposal of the second private proponent.
Mm-hmm. Terry, final question and big picture now. This is happening in the last minute, in the last 2 years of the Duterte administration. This could have been, as we were talking earlier, a legacy project, considering the infra push, this drive for the golden age of infrastructure touted by the Duterte administration. What now? I mean, given what's happening here and what they've accomplished in the last 4 years, how would you grade the Duterte administration's infra drive, infra push, the build?
Well, the DOTR has failed it miserably last week with the tollways and this week with the airport sector. And I'm quite certain that the president will not be too pleased with this development. Because for context, the first private proponent had taken 2 years in the making to be approved and ultimately be rejected. Is the third proposal, which I think the DOTR would want to see, take once again the next 2 years. And if we're talking about the next 2 years, the term of the president by then would already be finished, no? So I think responsibility, accountability for this entire problem rests solely on the DOTR and the MIAA. They have to explain to the public why the rehabilitation of the NAIA will not happen today, will not happen in the next few months.
Mm-hmm. Terry, before we let you go, I noticed that several times you referred to the NLEX problem, how the DOTR also failed that. Could you care to expound why? Because what's happening is the mayor of Valenzuela is just making, you know, the NLEX operator more accountable.
Well, I think we have to provide the context. In the manner that the tollways and the airports and all of the PPPs are a joint undertaking of the private sector and the public sector. And mm-hmm. not a single supportive statement, there was not a single supportive statement
okay.
that we had heard from the DOTR on the matter. All that they had stated is that, no, this matter is a local matter with Valenzuela and the toll operators. But I think what is most important in that point is that the entire idea of cashless tolling was originated by the DOTR itself in August of 2020. So I think it was very important for us to hear DOTR, for mm-hmm. us to hear TRB, explain and take accountability, take leadership for this entire brouhaha, not mm-hmm. just on the northern side of the toll roads, but for the entire policy of cashless tolling during the coronavirus crisis.
Okay, on that note, Terry, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you, Michelle. Good morning.